or two, or three.
Where the crept and the creek and the tombstones quake.
So boost them out for a swinging wake.
Happy hogs materialize
and begin to vocalize.
Great grinning ghosts come out to socialize.
And a happy Halloween to you, my mortal friends. Welcome back to the Haunted Mansion Show. I am your host, your ghost host. It's that special time of year again. All Hallows Eve, a time of tricks, a time of treats. Grim grinning ghosts coming out to socialize. And of course, many a peculiar ghost story being told from all corners of the earth, from Bloody Mary to the Headless Horseman. In our brief Halloween special in tonight's episode, I shall recount one very special tale to you. And, in the aftermath of such a dramatic retelling, I shall share with you some costume ideas some of our fans have created for this particular year. Now then, what ghost story shall we tell tonight, The Devil and Daniel Webster, perhaps? No, far too long. Perhaps that wonderful Halloween poem. No, that's far too short. I have just the one. Taken from the writings of famous ghostwriter Edgar Allan Poe, tonight I shall share with you one of the most classic and infamous tales of horror literature, The Raven. Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered weak and weary over many a curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as if someone gently rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I muttered, tapping at my chamber door. "Only this, and nothing more." Distinctly I remember. It was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow. Vainly I had sought to borrow from my books a crease of sorrow. Sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me. Filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, "'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. Some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This it is, and nothing more." Presently my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer. "Sir," said I, "or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping, tapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you." Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more. Deep into that darkness peering, long I stood there, wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word, Lenore. This I whispered, and an echo murmured back the word, Lenore. Merely this, and nothing more. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning. Soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before. Surely, said I, surely that is something at my window lattice. Let me see, then, what thereat is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind, and nothing more. Open here I flung the shutter, when with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obedience made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but with mien of lord or lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas, just above my chamber door, perched and sat, and nothing more. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore. Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven, ghastly, grim, and ancient raven wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore. Quote the raven,
Nevermore!
Much I marvel this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy bore. For we cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door, bird or beast upon the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such name as Nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing farther then he uttered, not a feather then he fluttered, till I scarcely more than muttered, other friends have flown before, on the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before. Then the bird said,
Nevermore!
Startled at the stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken, doubtless, said I, what it utters is its only stock and store, caught from some unhappy master, whom unmerciful disaster followed fast and followed faster till his songs one burden bore, till the dirges of his hope that melancholy burden bore, of never, never more. But the raven still beguiling all my fancy into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking, fancy unto fancy, thinking, what this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burn into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining, on the cushion's velvet lining that the lamplight gloated o'er. But whose velvet violet lining, with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press, ah, nevermore. Then, methought, the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer, swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor. Wretch, I cried, thy God hath lent thee, by these angels he hath sent thee, respite, respite, and nepenthe from my memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh quaff this kind nepenthe, and forget his lost Lenore. Quoth the raven. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still if bird or devil, whether tempter's sent or whether tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate yet all undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore. Quoth the raven.
Nevermore!
Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul with sorrow laden if, within the distant Aden, it shall clasp a sainted maiden whom the angels name Lenore, clasp a rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore. Quoth the raven.
Nevermore!
Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked upstarting. Get thee back into the tempest and the night's plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie thy soul hath spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart, and take thy form from off my door. Quoth the raven.
Nevermore!
And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting, still is sitting, on the pallid bust of Pallas, just above my chamber door, and his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming, and the lamplight o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor, and my soul from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor shall be lifted nevermore. A poet after my own empty heart. Edgar, you can fly down now. Good old Edgar. He's not called Edgar for no reason, you know. Now then, now that that's out of the way, and you're all settled in your Halloween ambiance, I'm sure you have everything you need, is that correct? Your carved pumpkins, your candy, little decorations here and there, lovely candlelight. But what of the costumes? Surely you haven't forgotten your costume today, have you? Have you seen today's date? It's the 31st, it's Halloween! How dare you have forgotten your costume on Halloween Day? Well, not to worry, though, for some of us have gotten our costumes quite early. Rather good. You see, I've asked some of you to share your Halloween costume ideas to showcase here on the show on this wonderfully spooky day. So let's take a look at the few that we have. Now here is one coming from Caesar. And it is a, rather strange creature, isn't it? A teenage mutant ninja turtle. Well, it does sound frightening, I'll give you that. I do like it, though. It is rather strange. It's not every day you see a mutant turtle walking around. There's so few of them out there. So thank you very much, Caesar. This next one... Oh my. Actually scared me. Comes from Josh. He comes this year as an evil dummy by the name of Slappy. You know, we have an evil dummy of our own. Actually, Xavier the Cadaver has his own one. And well, it's hard to tell who's the dummy, isn't it? I always love that joke. Well, thank you, Josh. Thank you. And last but not least, we have two of our friends with a double header. Both of which are the most dastardly villains that Disney has ever given us. Stromboli, the Master Showman, and Captain Hook, the slimiest crook in the world. They do look quite marvelous tonight, don't they? And you know something? I always do admire the best villains. As I mentioned just at the start of our episode tonight, one of these villains just so happens to be so treacherous, he can do it headless. I'm of course referring to the Headless Horseman. Oh, but don't let me tell you all about it. Madame Leota did so quite some time ago already, and I'd hate to upstage. But perhaps some of our musical friends can help. Let's go down to the graveyard and listen to the Phantom Five as they sing for us. Just how evil such a headless corpse can be.
When the spooks have a midnight jamboree, they break it up with fiendish glee. Ghosts are bad, but the one that's cursed is the Headless Horseman. He's the worst.
That's right, he's a fright on Halloween night.
When he clippity clubs a jockey across the land, holding his noggin in his hat, demons take one look and groan, and hit the road for parts unknown.
Beware, take care.
Now there's no spook like a spook that's spurned.
The ghosts don't like him and he's really burned.
And he swears to the longest day he's dead.
He'll show them that he can get ahead. Ba-choo-ba-choo-ba-da.
They say he's tired of his flaming top. He's got yen to make a swap. So he rides one night each year to find a head in the hollow here.
He likes them little, he likes them big, parted in the middle or a wig, black or white or even red.
The Headless Horseman needs a head.
So with a hip, hip and a clippity-clop, he's out looking for a top to chop. So don't try to figure out a plan, you can't reason with a headless man. For more than 100 years, that Headless Horseman has rode into infamy. Now some say he might finally rest in peace after all these years. But he cannot rest until he has a head on his shoulders. And it might be yours.
So when you're riding home tonight, make for the bridge with all your might. He'll be down in the hollow there. He needs your head, so look out and beware. With a hip, hip and a clippity-clop, He's out looking for a top to chop chop.
So don't try to figure out a plan.
You can't reason with a headless man.
Bravo, my friends. Always a treat to hear a song about a trick. Particularly about the Headless Horseman. The song reminds me of my recent vacation over to Sleepy Hollow, as a matter of fact. I was there just the other day, over in Phillipsburg Manor, to be precise. And that field, every October, has a particular pall over the air. The dead rise, and the living are hunted down by our headless horseman himself, of course. But the whole field has run amok with pirates and demons, severed heads, rolling everywhere. It does get quite nasty, I can confess. However, one such particular area that piqued my interest was Ichabod Crane's old schoolhouse just in the middle of the field. You see, Ichabod hasn't quite been himself since, well, his disappearance. Right over the old covered bridge that spans the brook, and well, he still teaches the class, yes. But let's just say that the students can get quite ahead of themselves. Ahead of themselves. Yeah, Sleepy Hollow is as haunted as ever, and I would recommend visiting the Hollow. Should you be in the area, we just might see each other there. Well, my friends, I hope you've enjoyed our brief Halloween visit. As always, enjoy your tricks and treats. Don your Halloween best. And please tell the Pumpkin King that I said hello.
If you would like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory. Mortals pay a token fee. Rest in peace, the haunting's free. So hurry back, we would like your company.